introduction. And what I'm going to do as we go along is the question and answer box. If there's some questions, I can see that. So if folks have questions as we're going along, if it makes sense for me to address them while I'm on a particular slide, I'll do so. If it's something, the topic that's coming up later, I may ignore it. So if you have questions, feel free to ask them, and I'll try to address them as we're going along. I am going to, not show my face as we're going along, but you should still be able to hear me just fine. Okay, so thanks again for having me. I appreciate the invitation. And, you know, this A2 topic is really a pretty popular topic. My research program isn't necessarily centered around A2. We do have one study where we're estimating some A2 frequencies and so forth, and maybe look at it in relation to some calf measures. But for the most part, not something I've studied a lot, but it is probably the most common question that I get is, should I be selecting for A2? What's A2 all about and so forth? So certainly a very timely and relevant question for us to be addressing here today. Okay, so let me go ahead and get started here, and we'll kind of look at the topics that we're going to cover today. I'm going to start by just giving a brief overview of the different milk proteins so you can see where A2 milk fits into all of this. We'll look at some of the research as it relates to human health, compare some breeds and some genetics, and talk about how quickly you can make your herd A2. Then we'll look at the A2 milk market and its growth. And then I'll have, I think, two slides on gene editing as maybe one possibility for this particular, how we might address it genetically. Okay, so in terms of milk proteins, there are basically two general classes. We have the whey proteins and the caseins. The whey proteins are those that remain soluble while the caseins coagulate and form cheese. So the whey proteins make up about 16% of the milk nitrogen. So most of our milk nitrogen, 97% of our milk nitrogen, would come from proteins, and the remaining 3% from non-protein nitrogen, or milk urea nitrogen, if you will. There's about 1% that comes from some of the cell membranes in the mammary gland, a lot of enzymes and so forth. And then 80% of our milk proteins are caseins. And there are different types of caseins, which we'll talk about in the next slide. But these caseins coagulate to form cheese. They also form micelles, which bind calcium and magnesium and other minerals during the cheese-making process. And caseins are about 80% of milk protein in ruminants, but only about 40% in humans. So caseins are very important in ruminants in particular. So there are essentially four different classes of caseins. We have alpha S1, alpha S2, beta, and kappa. And the names of some of these things, originally there was just one alpha, and then they determined that there were two different classes and separated those into alpha S1 and alpha S2. Milk proteins, because they're so easy to coagulate and so forth, are actually some of the most studied proteins in terms of the length of time they've been studied of really any class of proteins. So we know a fair amount about these proteins. And if we start to look at the breakdown of the different caseins as a percentage of total casein, about 40% would be alpha S1, 10% alpha S2, 35% would be our beta caseins, which is what we're talking about here today, and then about 15% would be the kappa caseins. And so one of the things that I want to point out is that there is a lot of variation in our milk protein genes. So alpha S1, for instance, there's an A, a B, a C, a D, an E, an F, a G, and an H. So several different varieties of alpha S1, four of alpha S2. beta casein, there's A1, A2, and that's, of course, our focus today. But there's also an A3, a B, a C, a D, an E, an F, a G, an H1, an H2, and an I. And so now, not all of these would all these variants would necessarily be relevant in dairy cattle. Some of them might be relevant in goats or water buffalo and so forth. But certainly A1, A2, and B are very relatively common in cattle. Generally speaking, though, we just lump everything that's not A1 or A2, we call it an A1. So Bs, we tend to lump in with A1s, at least, for example, when we're doing genotyping and presenting a bull's genotype information. And then, of course, there are the kappa caseins, and there's the A and the B are the most common. B is associated with high cheese yields, so that's actually the preferred variant of kappa casein. And then there's also something called the E variant of kappa casein, and that's actually a very unfavorable protein for cheese-making properties. And so, and there's a couple popular sires right now which happen to carry the E version of kappa casein. So that's actually not necessarily related to human health, but in terms of manufacturing properties of cheese, that's a pretty important protein as well. So the bottom line here is that there are lots of different caseins in milk and lots of different variations of those caseins. So that's a lot of natural variation here. Okay, next slide. So this is just a picture of a casein micelle. I'm not going to talk about this very much, but all the different caseins coagulate together. So it's not just a beta casein micelle or an alpha S1 micelle. It's all of them together. And kappa caseins tend to be on the surface, as I understand it. But that's just to give you kind of a picture of what a casein micelle looks like. This here, and we're not going to spend a lot of time on this. This is just the amino acid sequence of the beta casein. And in this particular instance, it's the A2 amino acid sequence for beta casein. And you can see there are 209 amino acids in beta casein. If we look at the A1 version of beta casein, that's due to one single amino acid change right here at, I think it's 67, amino acid number 67. So just a couple things here that I want to clarify. There are a few misconceptions that hopefully we'll kind of address as we go along a little bit. And so this just comes from one company that is marketing an A2 milk product. And they make a couple of claims here that aren't quite right. So first they claim that human intervention caused cows to develop A1 proteins in their milk. That's not true. This is a mutation that we think is probably a couple thousand years old anyway. So this is not something that we intentionally bred cows to do. It's not even associated with higher milk yield. It just happened to increase in frequency over time, like a lot of mutations do. It also states that all other mammals produce A2 milk. Beta casein mutations occur in every lactating species. So that's just those particular genes are not undergoing strong purifying selection, if you will. So we can have variation in those proteins, and that's certainly true in a lot of different species. That specific A1 mutation might be more specific to cattle, however. But the general idea that only cattle have mutations in beta casein is not correct. Okay, so what is the issue with A1 versus A2 milk? Well, it comes down to human health considerations. And there was a book that in particular got lots of attention and kind of brought this to the forefront a little bit. In the book, the title of the book was Devil in the Milk, and Illness, Health, and the Politics of A1 and A2 Milk. And so, and that was written by an ag economist. And so I will tell you that I think that this book actually hurt the A2 cause a little bit, because it's people that are trying to produce a wholesome and healthy product were a little bit offended when they were told that they were producing the devil's milk. And so they were turned off a little bit by it. And And I think that actually set A2 breeding back a little bit because people didn't take it seriously because they just thought it was hype and marketing. So we'll look a little bit at the illness and the health issues that are associated with A2 and talk about whether there's good support for that or not. We won't cover too much the political considerations, but I will tell you that I've not met any breeders who are opposed to breeding for A2 milk. Okay, so let's look a little bit more closely at the specific mutation and then the health effects that it's supposed to cause. So we've got an example here of the A2 beta casein and the amino acids in the A2 beta casein. And then we've got the A1 beta casein and the amino acids in the A1 beta casein chain. And so you can see here at position 67, we go from proline to histidine. And that makes this short little 7 amino acid nanopeptide cleave during digestion and maybe also during pasteurization, although that's maybe not entirely supported. So we get this 7 amino acid nanopeptide right here. And that nanopeptide is named beta casomorphin 7. Okay, and the beta is, of course, because this is the beta casein. Caso is for casein, and morphin is for morphine. And so this particular molecule is purported to have opiate-like qualities, at least in some people. And it's reported to be somewhat similar to gliadorphin, which is what causes some of the troubles with gluten in some people. Okay, so one thing that I do want to point out and is that this really has nothing to do with lactose. So some people think that beta casein is equivalent to lactose intolerance. It is not. So this is just a picture here of a lactose molecule, or just maybe not a picture so much as a diagram. And so lactose has a glucose that is bound to a galactose. Okay, so glucose plus galactose gives us lactose. Okay, and that compared to sucrose, table sugar would be a glucose plus a fructose. So there's differences in different types of sugars. But the lactase enzyme helps to break this two sugar molecule into monosaccharides. So it breaks the disaccharides into monosaccharides. And then those monosaccharides are then absorbed across the small intestine. So some people have a mutation that prevents them from producing lactase. And so if you can't produce lactase, then you can't break this disaccharide down, and that causes digestive issues with lactose. So beta casein and A1, A2 really have nothing to do with lactose intolerance. However, there are a lot of people who think they are lactose intolerant because they drank milk and it may give them digestive discomfort. And in fact, they may not be lactose intolerant. So a lot of people that think they're lactose intolerant may not be, and they may actually have an intolerance to the A1 protein, or at least that's the current theory, if you will. And one easy way to test that is that if you drink milk with the lactase enzyme added, or you take a lactase enzyme pill, and that doesn't help your symptoms, then that means that the issue is probably not lactose intolerance, but something slightly different. Okay, so here are some of the claimed health effects that are associated with A1 milk. So because of that opioid-like effect, it's thought that there are some immune processes that would be activated by A1 that could lead to, the initial claims were diabetes, heart disease, autism, and schizophrenia, among other things. And there were some initial studies that the A2 scientists used to claim there was support for this, but really those studies showed association and not cause and effect. So cause and effect sometimes can be a little tricky to determine. But basically they looked at areas with higher per capita consumption of A1 protein, those countries also tended to have higher rates of all of these particular diseases. So they thought that supported their hypothesis. That was then reviewed because obviously that's a pretty serious issue if there's a milk protein that's causing those issues. So there were a couple studies that explored and looked at this a little bit more carefully. One of those was the European Food Safety Authority reviewed the evidence for this in 2009. And they had a few different observations on the data that was available at that time. And the first was that they didn't think that beta-casomorphin 7 seemed to be a very potent opioid ligand. So its ability to bind and cause opioid-like effects, they didn't think were necessarily that strong. That they did acknowledge that it can bind to some of the same places that opioids might, but they didn't think it was necessarily a powerful effect. In addition to that, we have a gut barrier that would prevent the bovine beta casein morphin from being absorbed from our guts into our bloodstream. And then there was, in addition to that, there's a blood-brain barrier, and they didn't think that that molecule would be crossing the blood-brain barrier to cause some of the effects like autism and schizophrenia. And they also reviewed the association studies and found them not compelling. And so they recommended no risk assessment based on the data that was available. And so I was somewhat familiar with A2 at that point in time. And I, like a lot of other people, looked at these results and said, yeah, there's probably nothing to this whole A2 thing, and kind of dismissed it as a marketing gimmick and so forth, and didn't pay a lot of attention to it. That probably was a little bit of a mistake, because there does seem to be, well, some of those initial claims maybe haven't held up. There are some issues related to digestive comfort that maybe are on a little bit firmer basis. So for example, A1 in rodents does have effects on gastrointestinal function and many different pathways, including opioid-dependent and opioid-independent pathways. And it does affect gastrointestinal transit time. So A1 milk takes longer to move through the system than A2 milk, essentially. There have been some human studies as well, where those that claim to have lactose intolerant were put in a trial where they either got A1 milk or A2 milk, and the studies report reduced intestinal discomfort with A2 milk, reduced gastrointestinal inflammation in one study at least, some improved stool consistency, and reduced abdominal pain. So the one thing that I want to mention is that this is a couple of different studies that have come to these inclusions. So a couple studies, you know, that's compelling, but it's also not necessarily overwhelming evidence that this takes place. And one of the challenges that we have in scientific research is that when we perform a study that maybe doesn't support our hypothesis, there's usually less attention given to that study, and it may or may not ever be published. So a lot of times negative results don't get published. We do know that there are some human studies that reported better digestive health when consuming A2 products. What we don't know is how many studies there have been that have investigated this and either found no association or the reverse association. So even though there are studies that support it, we still have to view it somewhat cautiously. So there has been, however, there was a nice review article that looked at all the different studies, weighted them by the confidence they had in the studies and so forth. And I think that their conclusions were really quite responsible given the current state of information. Okay, so and they concluded that there is moderate certainty for adverse digestive health effects for A1 beta casein compared with A2, but low or very low certainty for other health effects. And that's kind of my conclusion reading the data as well, is that yes, there very likely is some, for some people at least, some A2 beta casein may in fact help improve digestion and make drinking milk a more pleasant experience. But in terms of health heart disease and diabetes and so forth, not a lot of evidence to support that hypothesis. And in fact, some evidence that would suggest we've looked at it and we don't see a case to be made there. And so that has changed how A2 has been responsible in terms of, I should say they've been responsive in terms of the changing scientific evidence. And in fact, they tend to focus on that indigestion issue and not so much on the other health effects. Okay, so we'll shift gears here a little bit and start to look at the genetics of some of these different things. And here's just an advertisement. This was a company from India that was selling their, name of the company is Desi. So they're selling their Desi A2 cow milk and advertising that milk from the native Bos Indicus breeds was good for health, and that milk from the Holstein Friesians was bad for health. And so we'll explore this a little bit and see if it's just Holsteins that are the problem, and if so, how we might be able to breed for that. I will tell you, I don't have quite the same numbers. These Bos Indicus breeds are not marketed in the United States. So finding population estimates of A2 for Bos Indicus in terms of what's easily available, we don't have good statistics for that. I will tell you the studies that have explored the gene frequency in Bos Indicus, so these humped cattle, if you will, generally they find that most of the cows are in fact A2, as this company is claiming, but not necessarily all of them. And so there is, at least in that population to some extent, some A1 cows as well. Now some of that, in fact, maybe even most of that is likely due to the fact that there's been some crossbreeding over time and some introduction of some taurine, European taurine cattle into those bloodlines, and they brought A1 along with that. But it would appear that for the most part, Bos Indicus cows are A2, but there are some exceptions for sure. So looking at the inheritance pattern here a little bit, every cow has two copies of the beta casein gene, of course, one that they inherited from their sire and one that they inherited from their dam. This particular beta casein expression is not a dominant recessive type of gene action that we might think of in terms of, for example, red coat color in cattle. You have to get two copies of the recessive allele for the cow to be red. That's not how it works for most traits, and A2 falls into that as well. So basically, both alleles are expressed, the allele from your father and the allele from your mother. So if you get an A1 from your father and an A1 from your mother, that cow will only produce A1 milk. If you get an A1 from your father or an A2 from your mother, then you produce basically half and half. Half the beta casein will be A1 and half the beta casein will be A2. And of course, the reverse is also true as well. If you get A1 from the mother and A2 from the father, half A1, half A2 beta casein. If you get A2 from the mother and A2 from the father, then that cow is producing only A2 milk. Okay, and so that is what the A2 milk company, for instance, would consider A2 milk. So let's, we'll go over here and look here at, on the next slide. If I can, my thing locked up, there we go. Okay, so let's look at some inheritance here for a second. Just give you some examples. This is all fairly straightforward. I'm sure a lot of you have done Punnett squares, genetic Punnett squares in biology class, some of us a long time ago, some of us more recently. But this is what we inherit from our dam in this particular case. We're assuming that we are breeding a cow that does not carry the A2 gene, so she's A1, A1. And we're going to mate her to a sire that's A1, A2. Okay, and you can see in half of our 50% of the time, we expect a calf that's A1, A1. And then 2 out of 4 down here, or the other 50% of the time we expect a calf that's A1, A2. Now, if we could look, we could also look at it this way, and this is maybe more typically what we think of when we evaluate Punnett squares. We have a heterozygous dam, so A1, A2 dam mated to a heterozygous father, A1, A2 sire. And in that particular case, one out of four, or 25% of our calves are going to be A1, A2. Two out of four, or 50% of our calves, A1, A2. I think I misspoke up here. That was 25% were A1, A1, obviously, and 50% A1, A2. And then 25% of our calves will be A2, A2. If we look at it, we use a sire that is A2, A2, mate to the exact same cow. Then in that case, we get 50% of our calves that are A2, A2. And then, of course, if we made an A2, A2 sire to an A2, A2 dam, we expect 100% of our calves to, in fact, be A2. So I kind of want to take this concept here of, in particular, looking at mating heterozygous to heterozygous and extend this to a population level. So this is, again, using a Punnett square, but maybe slightly differently than most have seen in the past. So what we've got here is at the population level, we're going to assume that 40% of the genes in the population, so we're not talking about an individual cow, we're talking about the entire national herd of Holsteins, for instance. We're assuming that 40% of the alleles are A1 and 60% are A2. Okay, so it doesn't matter whether this is sire or dam. We assume that the statistics or the averages are the same for the bulls and the cows, which is usually the case. So 40% A1, 60% A2 on this side as well. So then when we do our Punnett square and we form our squares here where we've got an A1, A1 calf, we expect that to happen 16% of the time. Okay, A1, A2 would be 24 plus 24 or 48% of the time. And then 36% of the time, we would expect a cow that produces A2, A2 milk. Okay, so using this picture up here from the A2 milk company, they call A2 milk, though only those animals that are producing pure A2, A2 proteins, and then ordinary milk is a mix of the two. Now, if we look at for example, another breed that has a really high frequency of the A2 gene. So 90% A2, 10% A1. Now we're talking about 81%. So basically 90% times 90% gives us 81% of cows that we expect to be A2 cows. So 19% ordinary milk, 81% A2 milk. All right, looking at some breed percentages here. So I've just gone to a few different websites of the bull studs and pulled down their bull populations, sorted them by A1, A2, and looked at it for different breeds. And so this is what you get. So Holstein bulls that are A1, A1 are actually only about 15% or so, and 47% of the Holstein bulls currently available are A2, A2. That frequency has grown. So the previous slide that I used where, let me go back up here, we said 36%. If it was 60, the gene frequency was 60% in the population, then we would expect 30% of cows to carry two copies of that allele. That is previously what we were observing. And now it's up to 47% in the Holstein population. So that suggests that we are seeing an increase in the frequency of the A2 gene in Holstein cattle. Jerseys, a little higher, 67%. About the same currently as what we see for Brown Swiss. The Guernsey bulls that I found that were available were 100% A2, A2. And we'll talk more about the Guernseys here as we go along, but they are, as a breed, they have taken advantage of what they have seen as a marketing opportunity for A2 milk because they are a breed that had a higher level of the A2 gene to begin with, and they have further capitalized on that. And now they essentially have made it their policy that they don't want bulls that are not A2A2 marketed, because they want to maintain that potential competitive edge. Norwegian Red is offered by one bull stud, about 17 sires. I think of the 17 sires, 14, if I remember correctly, were A2A2. If we look at other red breeds like Ayrshire, there's not as many marketed, so the sample size isn't very high, but they're probably a little closer to Holstein. So 47% in Holsteins carry two copies of the A2 gene. And you can see there's also 42% or so that are heterozygous. So one copy of A1, one copy of A2. And when you do the math to figure out what percent of beta casein genes are A2 in the Holstein population, that comes out to about 68%. So A2 is the predominant gene in, even in Holsteins. Okay, so, but because we have to have two copies of that A2 allele to actually produce pure A2 milk, slightly less than half of Holsteins probably produce pure A2 milk. Brown Swiss and Jerseys, about 83 to 84%. With rounding, Brown Swiss were slightly higher, but basically this the same. 83 to 84% is the frequency of the A2 gene in those populations. 100% in the Guernsey bull population. The Guernsey cow population is probably in the 90 to 95% range. And then about 90% in the Norwegian red bull population. So we can now do, of course, genetic testing for A1 and A2. And a few different companies, probably the ones that are most common in the U.S. would be Zoetis, Neogen, and Genetic Visions. The standalone tests, typically $25 to $30. You'll find some variety in there based on volume discounts and so forth. But basically, if you're genetically testing your animals for only A2, you're going to expect to pay $25 to $30 depending on the company and how many animals you test. Maybe a little bit less than that if you really have a very large number of animals. If it's packaged with genomic testing, then it's only an addition, I shouldn't say only, it's an additional $5 to $10 that you'll be paying to get that additional information when you do a genomic test. And so, it's not necessarily expensive for them to test for A1 versus A2, but they do have to pay the A2 milk company to license that particular test. So how quickly can we get there to an A2 herd of cows by just using A2 sires? And this is just an example of a bull. You can see he is A2, A2. So if we use this kind of bull, assuming that about half of our cows now are, or assuming that the frequency of A2 in our population is 50%, and it's actually probably a little closer to 60%, but to be conservative, I estimated here 50%. It would take us a couple decades to get to a pure A2, A2 herd. That's assuming a 3.5-year generation interval. So that's our cows on average, including our two-year-olds and our older cows, are 3.5 years old, and our bulls that we're using are 3.5 years old. So we could do it a little bit more quickly if we used younger bulls and younger cows and so forth. But for most herds, those are reasonable assumptions. So a couple decades to get there on average. If on the other hand, we use some testing, we use A2 sires, and then we also cull our calves that are born that are not A2. So I'm assuming here we could cull up to 25% of our calves, which would be, in the later years, we wouldn't need to cull that many, but early on, we could get there in half that time, basically a decade to do it in that particular instance. Okay, so we're going to shift gears here just a little bit and start to look at the market for A2 milk. and explore that a little bit here. So in the U.S., A2 was introduced in the stores, began to be introduced in about 2015. And typically the price for A2 milk is about the same as an equivalent volume of organic milk. So there is a premium that people are paying in order to consume this product. The market is controlled by the A2 milk company, and there are various patents on both the milk and the gene that they control. So their position would be that only they can license A2 milk products. I want to just tell you, in the interest of full disclosure here, I am not a lawyer. So the legal risks that are involved in marketing A2 milk without having the A2 milk company involved with would be speculative on my part. Their position would be, of course, that only they can license the product. But there may be some ways around that. But again, you need to talk to your lawyer about that. For example, I'm not sure that they could prevent marketing based on breed-based claims. So for instance, Golden Guernsey, you could market the Golden Guernsey breed as very high in A2 milk, and here's my Guernsey milk. So you're not calling your milk A2, but you're saying it's coming from a breed that's all A2. Can they prevent those type of marketing claims? I don't know the answer to that. I think that they would certainly try, but whether they'd be successful or not, I don't know. In addition to that, it's the patent rights around patenting a gene have become much, much more restrictive. So you can't patent natural phenomena, for instance. So I think it's possible that a bull company, for instance, could gene edit A2 and probably whether that would be allowed or not under patent law would probably be something that would have to be decided in courts. But the possibilities are there anyway. We tend to think of the fluid A2 milk market, but there's actually multiple products that are available. So their baby formulas and infant formulas are really quite popular. There are some places that have yogurt at least, and some places that have cheese available. I have not actively looked at the store for A2 cheese, so I don't know if it's here in the U.S. On a large scale. And then, of course, fluid milk has been their largest focus to date. I would expect that, much like we see in the organic market, the fluid market, as that becomes more saturated, we'll start to see more diversity of other products like cheese and butter and yogurt and so forth. The growth characteristics in the A2 milk market are really quite impressive. So this is just looking at this chart here. The revenue in New Zealand dollars is the New Zealand-based company. So in 2007, it was about 7.6 million. 10 years later, 550 million. 1 year later, 923 million. And so you can actually buy shares in the A2 milk company. And it is really phenomenal growth in the last year. So you can certainly see that a lot of people are attracted by the A2 health claims. And any claims at all in the food industry, health claims at all in the food industry, of course, right now are very popular, and A2 is certainly no different. In terms of sourcing their milk, so some of the key characteristics, they want farms that are close to their processing centers, which is really quite obvious. The farms that do provide A2 milk receive a premium. And a lot of the A2 milk comes from what we might call split herds. So this would be a large herd of cows where they can have basically a string of cows that are their A2 cows. And those A2 cows maybe get milked into a separate tank and delivered to be processed for A2 milk. So even though Holsteins have a somewhat lower frequency of the A2 milk gene, there are a lot more Holsteins than cows from other breeds. And so because of this, I think most of our A2 milk in the stores likely comes from Holsteins. So I think that you know, obviously they're no different than any other processor. They would prefer to source their milk cheaply and sell it at a high price. So they're going to look for farms that are close to them. And so the larger herds are probably providing the bulk of the A2 milk product at this point. They are now developing lots of partnerships. Okay, so Fonterra, worldwide, a very big milk processor, might be the largest. They have an arrangement with Fonterra now as well to help increase the A2 milk delivered to the market. Sinlac in New Zealand, Nestle. They have a partnership with Nestle related in particular, to, in this particular picture, to the baby food market. And also the China State Farm. They have a partnership that's been ongoing with the China State Farm. And in particular, that tends to be centered around their baby formula. And I think part of the reason for that is that some of you may recall the melamine controversy that occurred in China, where some of the processors were adding a non-protein source of nitrogen to the milk to make it look like it had lots of protein. And that was, of course, associated with some tragic health events. So that made people awfully suspicious. And so the market space opened up for A2 claim to have healthier milk for your children. And so that's been a successful venture for them that they've recently reestablished as well. So those are some partnerships with A2. There are some companies that appear to be doing some independent marketing of A2 milk, and most of these are related to the Guernsey breed. I don't know what sort of contact they've had with the A2 milk company, if they've had any, but there's Origin Milk in based a Cleveland based company, and they're sourcing a lot of their milk from, or all of their milk from Guernsey herds. So they're combining that golden Guernsey milk with A2, if you will. Yoder Farm Market in Pennsylvania here, they don't necessarily market their milk as A2 milk exactly, but they market that Guernseys have higher A2, and this is our golden Guernsey milk and ice cream. And then there's another farm here, I forget the name of, that similar type of as Origin, marketing their milk as A2 milk. So one of the issues that I think A2's interest in partnering with these larger companies bring up is that currently A2 milk is a premium product for which producers receive a premium. And I think one of the things that we need to kind of look forward and ask ourselves is, could this become a standard? And I'll use an example of not treated with RBST or bovine growth hormone. That initially kind of started out as a niche market, you know, we're marketing that our cows are treated differently because they aren't given growth hormone. Well, now, of course, that is taken over the market, and that's no longer do you get paid a premium for not treating your cows with RBST. That's just the industry standard, and that's what everybody's expected to do, and nobody receives a premium for that. And so I think one of the questions we have to ask ourselves is, will this become the standard going forward? And if it is, how do I position myself to have as little disruption to my business down the road as possible? And so I think what I tell producers is, I don't know that we are so close to that point where you need to be breeding exclusively for A2 sires at this point. But if you are, if I'm choosing between two bulls that are otherwise pretty similar, they're both meeting my interests in terms of what my genetic selection program for my herd might be, I would suggest using the A2 sire to break that tie and to slowly start working on increasing the frequency of A2 in your herd so that if we do get to a point where it becomes the industry standard, you're able to respond to that with as little disruption as possible. We're always looking for alternatives, of course. So Calvin and Hobbes is always my favorite comic strip, and Calvin was certainly always looking for alternatives. And so in this particular case, he didn't have to eat the dinner that mom cooked. He got to get himself a pizza with extra pepperoni. So what are some possible alternatives when it comes to breeding for increased frequency of A2? One of those could be gene editing. So we have the company Recombinetics, for instance. They have genetically modified, that's maybe not quite the correct term, they gene edited calves. So basically they've introduced the pulled mutation into some calves. So calves whose parents both had horns, they introduced the hornless gene or the pulled gene through a gene editing process, and the calves were born without horns. So I think that that is possible. We could very quickly essentially make all of our AI bulls A2 through gene editing. But will that happen? I'm not sure, because there are lots of regulatory hurdles that remain in place. And in addition to that, there's just basically a consumer acceptance question. So in general, those consumers that are most concerned about health, are they going to be the ones that are most likely to be resistant to gene-edited products? And I tend to think that's going to be the case. So I am not convinced that gene editing for A2 will be what takes us to the A2, all the way to A2 marketing in the future. But we'll see. So this slide, I think, captures pretty well some of the challenges that we as dairy producers are facing. So we've got people that don't eat various products for lots of different things. Are they gluten-free? This fella's lactose intolerant. He's probably actually really A1 beta casein intolerant, so he wouldn't be able to eat that as well. And so, of course, they would tend to not be GMO friendly as well. So just to kind of quickly summarize all of some of the main points that I'd like to leave you with, and then I'll open it up for questions. I don't think we've had any questions so far, but I'll certainly open it up in case there are a few that come along. So first, the A2 milk market is growing rapidly. It grew 60% from 2017 to 2018. And I think that's going to continue. As with a lot of technologies, the early adopters are the most likely to benefit from this because eventually the market becomes saturated or becomes the standard of the market, and then everybody's producing A2 milk and nobody's getting a premium for it. So already the Guernsey breed really has done a nice job of positioning their breed as the breed that can provide A2 milk. So they, Guernsey breed in general, I would consider an early adopter of this. So if you are interested in becoming part of the A2 milk market and see that as a way to maybe help your revenue stream, I think I would get to work on that fairly quickly. But that's easier said than done. You have to be close proximity to an A2 milk market processing center, at least, not everybody has that option. I think what troubles people is that we've got all this A2 milk that's selling for almost twice as much as regular milk, and it, in their minds, it may make their product look inferior, and it's based on health claims that are generally uncertain. So I understand why people sometimes react unfavorably to A2 milk claims. The digestive comfort claims do have some support. Whether that support remains with larger studies and more controlled studies, only time will tell. The good news is that sires from all breeds are available. Guernsey breeders are already capitalizing, and I would recommend really any breeder, even if you have absolutely no interest in A2 and providing A2 milk, if you've got two bulls that are similar that you're considering, pick the bull that's A2. Okay, so with that, I'll be happy to answer any questions that might pop up. And so let me go ahead and find out. I was going to click back on my camera here so that I could see you, but I'm having trouble getting that to pop up. So I'll just, we do have one question. And so the question is it worth the price to test a herd of bred heifers for A2A2 to sell the heifers? And of course, the answer to that depends entirely on whether you think you're going to be able to market those heifers for a premium. If you can test a heifer for, depending on how you're doing it, $5 to $25, and you get a $50 premium for the heifer, then the answer to that is yes. Of course, the one thing that we have to keep in mind is that some of your heifers are going to come back and not be A2A2. And so then, do you diminish the value of those heifers more than you enhance the value of the A2 heifers? So I think definitely if I've got a market where people, where I know that I'm going to be able to have a higher return on heifers that are A2A2, then the cost is not onerous. And I would say yes. But if you're just doing it hoping that your heifers are going to be more valuable because they're A2A2, then I'm not certain. I'd want to have a good idea that I'm going to be able to have that market before I invest in that particular test. Okay, and another question here relates to where milking shorthorns and Dutch belted cattle fit on the A1, A2 spectrum. And the short answer is that I don't know that we know. I did look at milking shorthorn bulls. As you can imagine, there weren't very many. And the milking shorthorn bulls I looked at, I think there were three at one bull stud, and one of those bulls was A1, A2, and the other were A2, A2. So based on a sample size of three, it appears that milking shorthorn bulls or the milking shorthorn population carries both the A1 and the A2 gene. A2 gene is probably more frequent than the A1 gene, but the exact frequency, I don't know. The other issue with milking shorthorns is that they have introgressed a lot of Holstein genetics over the last decade or so. So certainly they're going to, and I don't know that they've paid attention to A2 as they've done that. It's been more for show purposes, frankly. So I would expect that they're going to be a little closer to the Holstein than some of the other, than they would be to Guernsey, for instance. So probably intermediate Holstein to Guernsey. Dutch belted, I just have no idea at all. I would guess that there's some Holstein and Dutch belted as well, and they probably have a mix of A1, A2, but that's just a complete guess. Hopefully an educated guess, but still a guess. All right. Okay.
Looks like no other questions. Oh, one more.
Okay, so in terms of the best company or website to contact for genetic testing, the two companies that I generally work with the most for genetic testing and that have had good experiences with are Neogen, and the second company would be Zoetis. So, and it depends a little bit on the breed. Both companies are fine for either breed. There are some advantages if you're working with Holsteins and you're also doing genotyping. Zoetis has a relationship with the Holstein Association that is sometimes beneficial, but really, it's the same genetic test from both companies will cost about the same. So Neogen and and Zoetis are the two companies, and I can certainly, I'll give you my email address, and anybody that has questions that they want to follow up with is certainly welcome to email me, and I can provide the hyperlinks to those tests directly for you if you want. And so my email address is C as in Chad, D as in David, D as in David, the number 1 at PSU for Penn State University .edu. So again, C DD1 at psu.edu. And if you have any questions on those types of resources, I'd be happy to provide them. Okay.
All right. Thank you, Chad.
Yep. Thank you.
Very nice presentation. Thank you very much.
No problem.
So you can end sharing. And Bill, are you there?
Yeah.
All right. You can start up your presentation. Our next speaker is Bill Ferris, who is a risk management specialist with USDA Risk Management Agency. Bill is located in Northeast office in Raleigh, North Carolina. And